Great. Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining the Sonoma County Vintners Scion webinar today. We are so delighted to have such great panelists today to be able to talk about such a pressing issue for the wine industry. I will begin in a few minutes, but I wanted to go over a few housekeeping items. Number one, this webinar is recording. And we will be distributing this via email in the next week or so, so that if you have any team members that weren't able to make it today, you can share it with them. And you can also reference back to all the materials that are going to be shared today. So the second item is that our panelists would like to encourage you all to participate by directing any questions, comments, or concerns into the chat function, and they will be monitoring the chat as we dive into this discussion, and we'll be able to answer some questions throughout the discussion. So again, thank you all for being here, and I'd love to introduce you all to our amazing panelists and longtime partners. We have John Hinman and Barbara Snyder from Carmichael, or Hinman and Carmichael LLP. And we have Kim Cochran and Jeremy Little with Carl Mackey Power and Roth. So thank you all for being here. This is going to be a really great discussion, and we're happy to have you. So without further ado, I will turn it over to John to get the conversation started.
Okay. Welcome. And we're going to start with the program right now. Today, we're going to be talking about the California ABC's new Responsible Beverage Server Training Program. This is something that's been in the works for approximately 3 years. It's going to impact everybody on this call in different ways, depending on what kind of activities that you perform at your winery. I'll be presenting along with my colleague, Barbara Snyder, this morning. And if there's questions during the presentation, please put them in the chat room and we will get to them as quickly as possible. There's a lot of material here to cover. And without further ado, let's talk about the Responsible Beverage Server Training Program. It's now ABC Rules 160 to 173. The enabling legislation was passed in 2017. It was directed to the ABC to develop, implement, and administer a curriculum for training of servers throughout the state by July 1st, 2021. Well, obviously that's approximately 2 weeks from now. The purpose of the new law was to reduce alcohol abuse by customers on-premise licensees. The implementation got delayed for a year because of the COVID pandemic changes. So it's now going to be implemented effective July 1st, 2022. That is almost tomorrow from a perspective of how much has to be done by licensees in this state before that time. I don't want to understate the gravity of the preparation that's going to be required. All new employees, all current employees and managers have to be certified with the program in the sale of alcoholic beverages by July 1st, 2022. After July 1st, 2022, if you hire any new people, they have 60 days to take the course and to pass it. To date, there's only 13 approved RBS providers listed on the ABC website. We are certain that there will be a last minute rush to have employees certified, and because no employees may serve alcoholic beverages unless they're certified. This is going to impact every winery tasting room in the state of California. It's going to impact every restaurant. It's going to impact every licensed venue. And we're going to go into that a little bit more detail on that in a minute. However, your businesses should plan for the cost that will be incurred in server training. The ABC has estimated approximately 1 million employees will need to be certified in the next year. We estimate that there's closer to 10 million who will need to be RBS certified by July 1st, 2022. The reason is because you just multiply the number of licenses with on-premise privileges times the number of employees, and you get to close to 10 million people in the state of California. Kim?
Hey, John. if there's 10 million people that have to get certified, there's only 13 providers. How is that going to work numbers wise to get everybody trained?
Really, really good question, Kim. that's, you know, there's going to be online training programs, certainly. And we don't know how many of those are going to be able to reach. And that's one of the unanswered questions about the program going forward, is how are we going to train all these people? I presume that the Trade Association, and Madison, you could tell me about this, if possible, is going to probably try to qualify as a certified trainer so that they can, in fact, assist the winery members in complying with these particular requirements.
Yes, this is definitely something that we're looking into.
In addition, we expect that the ABC is still continuing to review trainer applications, so hopefully there'll be more. But it's a complicated procedure, and it costs $1,000 for a trainer to be approved.
Yes, and it's going to be there's going to be a lot of difficulties between now and next a year from now, when the program actually is required to be in place, operational, and people trained. So starting now is the key. The slide in front of you right now basically talks in broad strokes about the curriculum in the ABC rules 160 to 173. The definition of a server is defined as anyone who checks identification of the age of a patron. This includes security guards and bouncers at entertainment events and venues. So for example, the security guards at Oracle Park checking in people for a baseball game will be required to be RBS certified. Anybody that delivers an alcoholic drink to a patron, this would be people that are hired by catering crew to service a wedding, for example, at an out of the way location. Anybody that takes an order for a patron's alcoholic beverage drink. This is kind of obvious at a restaurant because you're talking about a waiter or waitress taking an order. It's less obvious when you're at a location where you're doing wine tastings. Anybody that pours an alcoholic drink for a patron is going to be required to be trained and certified. Then we get to the kicker here, which is the manager requirement. A manager is anyone who oversees the performance of alcoholic beverage servers. Sounds self-evident. It's who's ever in charge of the location and the venue at the time. And every manager must also take the course and be RBS certified. Now, what's important about this is a certified manager must be on the premises at all times when alcoholic beverages are being served. This also applies to one-day event permit. Jeremy, do you think this has any staffing implications for wineries?
I was just going to go there, John, because I can imagine the number of tasting rooms we have around here and the office manager, the CFO, the business manager, who is never in the tasting room, probably has never poured, but is the person on charge, in duty, overseeing the tasting room staff. Those folks are now going to have to be certified, correct?
Correct, and certified as managers, which is a higher standard than, generally speaking, than the certification process itself, although it's the same course and the same test. Isn't that correct, Barbara?
That's correct. It's the same. And John, we have a question already. What about people whose roles are not hospitality, but might pour at a special event?
They have to be certified.
And winemakers too, right?
The one exception is that if the special event is a nonprofit event.
And we have an item in one of the slides about that particular point.
Right.
So Barbara, why don't you get into what kind of businesses are affected by the certification response, by the certification requirement? Maybe you can review this with us really quick.
Sure. Basically, it's every on-premises licensee, whatever the on-premise licensee is, restaurants, tasting rooms. And for example, if the winemaker helps in the tasting room, even though he's the winemaker, he will have to be certified also. One-day event permits, as we said, you need to have people certified, and you need to have at least one certified manager. Bars, entertainment and music venues, we talked about Bottle Rock. stadiums, you talked about baseball, football. Hotels have serving drinks in many locations. Catering businesses for weddings, events, and as we discussed, security guards and bouncers who are checking IDs.
Now you can see from this how quickly we got to our 10 million person threshold. John, we're talking about practically the entire hospitality business in the state of California. This is a massive program.
Yeah, John, another question just popped in, just sort of on that manager idea. And the question was about whether there's an assistant tasting room manager. Would that person count as an actual manager?
If they're certified as a manager, yes.
If they're certified, and if it sort of goes up that chain of your employment structure, whoever's overseeing those folks that are pouring, they fall into that category.
Right. Now, the interesting thing, Jeremy, is we haven't looked at the labor implications of appointing someone as a manager. I mean, that has implications under other statutes and regulations as the responsibility of a manager. But yeah, you can have multiple managers, and you probably will have to. If you make all of your employees managers, for example, is that a way around this? Well, perhaps, but that has other implications from a perspective of their authority over the operation of the premises as being identified as a manager. And there's actually an ABC rule about qualifying managers of on-premise locations. I don't think this applies necessarily to wineries, but it's ABC, I believe it's rule 66, isn't it, Barbara?
Yes.
That requires within 15 days of appointment of a manager, you're required to have the manager go into the ABC and be qualified as if it were a licensee. So that's going to be, that's an open question right now under these particular regulations, is who is really a manager? We still don't know the answer to that. But however, there are exemptions to the certification requirements. And that's what this slide happens to be about right now. And exemption number one is marketing of wine to distributors, wine, beer, spirits. So producers are exempt from having their salespeople necessarily who are sampling retail and other accounts to be RBS certified. This is a good thing. I mean, if you can imagine your entire sales force having to be beyond the force in the taste room having to be certified, this is a good exemption. The second exemption is academic instructors. These are people that are running wine knowledge programs at Santa Rosa Junior College, at Sonoma State, at Davis, and so forth throughout the state. Those folks in the classroom setting are having a specific exemption from the qualification program. You know, it's kind of surprising when you look at that, because those are the people that probably know more than anybody else about the specifics of the program, and yet they've been exempted from the requirement. They did exempt beauty salons, barbershops, who provide complimentary alcoholic beverages to clients from being certified. And finally, Barbara, you want to explain how the exemption works for nonprofit events?
Right. At nonprofit events, the actual people serving do not need to be certified, but the condition is you must have a certified manager overseeing those who are doing the pouring.
So it's only, Barbara, it's only one person has to be certified at a nonprofit event?
Only the manager needs to be certified at a nonprofit event.
Now, is it the responsibility, you think, of the winery to inform the nonprofit that they're contributing product to, that this is a requirement?
I would expect that would be a good practice.
I mean, Kim, would you think that would be the responsibility of the winery that's contributing wine to a nonprofit to instruct them on what their responsibilities are?
You're asking the litigator, and my job as a litigator is to reduce risk. Absolutely. Absolutely, I agree with you.
Yeah, this is one of the open questions on this particular topic that we have. There will be a lot more questions between now and July 1st, 2022. But the point is to start thinking about it and start moving towards getting your people certified so you have the least amount of hassle when it implements, because it's going to be a zoo. July 1st, 2022 is going to be hideous as we approach it.
We have a few questions before you begin on this slide. Yeah, sure. One question was a clarification question, and it's, so if the winemaker is pouring wine for say their oenologist to do tasting as a part of their analysis work, they also need to be certified?
No.
Okay.
No, we would say that would be exempt under the exemption we just described for, you know, producers providing training.
Great.
And, you know, that would be, but, you know, frankly, I would say to any winery that asked me, get your winemaker certified. It, you know, they're going to be in a tasting room at some particular point in time instructing a customer. And for that, they need to be certified. So I think all winemakers in this state should pass the certification program as early as possible. I mean, that's our recommendation.
Great.
They don't have
John,
to.
Would it?
Yeah. Yes, Kim.
Sorry, John, would it be your suggestion that the winemaker maybe be certified as a manager, since he or she would generally be on site, for at least for the smaller wineries?
Again, yes, subject to the employment criteria of being identified as a manager. That's a question that's beyond the scope of this particular presentation today, but that is very much a question of how, when you identify somebody as manager with managerial authority, that has other implications.
Mm-hmm.
And Jeremy, I mean, your firm does a lot of that work. And, you know, if you might want to say something about that, about ostensible authority.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's this interface and this, you know, overlapping legal questions that arise. You know, manager in the ABC world is different from the manager in our other labor law, employment law realm. If that person has the authority to hire and fire and set salaries and things of higher executive nature, right? That's a different type of manager than what we're talking about here within the ABC idea of a manager who is overseeing others that are interfacing with consumers that are taking in your product.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be necessary.
A manager is defined in the ABC rules as somebody also who hires as well as oversees.
So there does need to be some clarification of this particular issue. My fear is that you either get socked with a labor law issue by appointing somebody as a manager, or failure to qualify them under the ABC rules. And there always has to be a qualified manager on site when you're conducting tasting activities. This is one of those big question marks that we're going to be exploring throughout the rest of this year before the program springs into full force and effect in July 1st, 2022. Now, you might ask yourself, what do I have to know to be certified? What knowledge base are they asking me to cover? We've got a slide in front of us right now on five general subjects that are covered in the curriculum for training. And this is a very detailed curriculum. And the five general subjects are, first, the social impact of alcohol. Barbara, can you tell us what's going to be covered in that particular segment?
Right. Want to go through all the different regulations and laws to reduce the impact of alcohol use on the community and neighborhood. So you're going to look at DUIs, domestic violence, noise, litter, crime, and the push on resources, the police department, the fire department, the emergencies. So that's basically what that section is going to cover.
So every server of alcoholic beverages in your tasting room has to know about the social impact of alcohol?
Correct.
How about the impact of alcohol in the body, including the impact of using drugs with alcohol? What's that about?
That is a physiological analysis, how the alcohol is absorbed, the role of the liver, symptoms, to observe symptoms when you're combining drugs and alcohol. You should be aware of the blood alcohol concentration, BAC, which is the test they give for DUIs.
There's a very long list of ABC state laws and regulations that are mandated for coverage in the resource materials. And there's a lot of these, including the laws and regulations related to driving under the influence. There's a lot of these, frankly, I've been practicing alcohol law now for over 40 years. I had to look these up. And if I have to look them up, let me tell you how hard it's going to be for someone that hasn't been doing this for a long time to figure it out. For the first thing is the certification law. Okay, well, that's a statute. You obviously, that's the responsible beverage service statute itself. Then you're going to be responsible for knowing the certification regulations, which is the 13 rules that have been adopted by the ABC to implement this particular law. And then you're going to have to know the prohibition exactly against serving alcohol without compliance with the certification. That's 25683. You have to know the disciplinary effect of a certification violation. That's 25684. Then you've got the definition of and penalties for infractions, misdemeanors, and felonies in California. So you basically need to be a California criminal lawyer as you go forward. The people that are certified will all be ready for law school by the time they finish with this particular course. You're gonna need to know the sale of alcohol to minors, all the laws, all the policies and the punishments. That's 25658 A, C, and D. We know that statute really well because that's the sale to minor statute that gets prosecuted and tried. There's a prohibition against minors on sale licensed premises. That's 25665. That one doesn't apply to most wineries because most wineries don't have an on-premise public license. That applies to bars where people under the age of 21 aren't permitted. You're gonna know about the requirements of selling to obviously intoxicated persons, 25602A. This does apply to a winery because you don't want someone that's been on a wine tasting tour to come into the tasting room and to be weaving back and forth and then go back out on the road. And if you sell to them, you're going to be not only liable for the damages, especially if they're underage, but a license liable for for your license being suspended or revoked. Several years ago, we did a very difficult case out of an automobile accident at 2:30 in the morning coming from one of the top restaurant venues in Sonoma County. And it was a tragic case and it led to a death, but it was three trials on not only revoking the license of the establishment, but bringing in experts on the whole concept of alcohol intoxication on the body. And as it finally turned out, the person wasn't intoxicated. It was very difficult. What they really were is they had pasta and it had fermented. Yeah, really, Kim, honest to God, this was an incredible case. So I don't want to go into detail right now, not the time, but ask me later.
Yeah, and, I'd like to talk to you about that.
Yeah, we had expert witnesses involved, including the Sonoma County Coroner, to figure out what was really the cause of death in this particular case.
And death by pasta.
Death Who by knew? Pasta, as versus death by drinking shots. But that's a subject too. Drunken public is a law in California. You're gonna need to know that law. And what does drunken public mean? If somebody comes into your tasting room weaving, does that mean that they're drunk in public and they can't be served? I guarantee you, if a police officer comes in after them, he's gonna have a very different view of that person than you are. But you're gonna need to know the law here. Prohibition on employment of minors in public premises. Again, this is one that doesn't really pertain to most wineries. It pertains to bars that have entertainment in them, and they don't permit minors for any purposes except for entertainment. And then they have to be on a stage 6 feet away from the audience and 18 inches above the ground, which is a stupid rule, but it is what it is. But you're gonna need to know about it. So I'm looking forward to testing people on that particular rule. Obviously, you're gonna know the law against permitting the sale or consumption of controlled substances. This is one that's going to get really tricky. There's four or five different parts that are specific here. That's 24200 Point five is a general requirement of any controlled substance on a licensed premise. 25.621.5 is a prohibition on the sale of cannabis or infusing wine with cannabis. The cannabis requirements are being enforced. You're not allowed to permit cannabis use or sale on a licensed premise right now in California, and your wineries are licensed premises. I don't know if anybody's wine, if anybody on this call has winemaker, has ever lit up a joint in the cellar. I don't know if that's ever happened.
I'm sure it has not. Not advice of counsel, they're not going to answer that question. Too.
But I'll tell you right now, or even outside on part of the licensed premises, you know, because obviously cannabis is lawful for private use. It's not lawful on winery or licensed premises. That's wineries, restaurants, bars, for that matter, hotels, any particular premises. You're going to be required to know the vehicle code offenses involving drugs or alcohol. That's 23, 152, A, B, and G. That's both possession, use, and and control. You're going to obviously need to know the laws on permitted hours of operations. This impacts a lot of people differently because a lot of people have conditions on their licenses that limit the hours that they can operate, that they can be open in a tasting room or in a restaurant or bar or anything else. This is often the result of negotiations with neighbors that came about when you're originally licensed. There's an entire statute that deals with those particular issues, statutory, that's 25.631 and 25.632. Finally, the prohibition on smoking cannabis in public in the Health and Safety Code. And we have defended these cases, by the way, and they're very difficult to defend. And the cannabis production and sale requirements. Now, there's also a role of local law enforcement officers authorized to enforce the alcohol laws. And there's a requirement to send the ABC all arrest reports and call for service at ABC licensed locations. This is something that's done as a matter of course. You may not know about it, but your local police department does this. This is the educational part of the program. So be prepared to know all these particular subjects, be tested on them, and to be certified on them. And Barbara, what's the pass rate requirement for the test?
70%.
Is that for managers and servers?
Yes.
What happens if you fail the program?
You have 30 days from the date you finish the course to take the exam, and you have 3 attempts. You can fail twice. If you fail the third time, then you have to start all over again, take the course all over again, and then try to pass the exam again.
Well, from our labor experts here, Jeremy and Kim, I mean, is that time off that's paid for at work? Is that work-related time?
Neither of us are labor experts, but thanks for putting us in that box. So this is when you should contact your attorney, and they will contact the employment department for a definitive answer on that perspective. There is the PR part of running a business, right? Which is you got to keep your employees happy. And it's probably a little bit of money in order to keep them happy and go ahead and let them do it on company time. That would be my recommendation. Whether it's legally required or not is a different question.
Yeah, it'd be my recommendation also, because it's prudent. It's a prudent thing to do to protect yourself. The other,
and certain, you're making sure that they're doing it. Exactly. They're not doing it in their spare time and they don't get around to it.
Exactly. We all know that almost all employees are very responsible and never slough off on their duties and never fail to follow through. The general subjects that, again, we're talking about is intervention techniques to prevent the service sale to alcohol beverages to minors or intoxicated persons. Barbara, what kind of record keeping is required for that?
In order to be sure that you are covered for any claims or accusations, you need to keep an intervention log. This is every winery, any on-premises service should have an intervention log. And the intervention log lists the date, the time, the server, what happened, and how it was resolved. And you need to keep that in your records.
Does the management have the responsibility to develop written policies for employees?
Absolutely.
And that's specific?
It is a specific requirement. It should be written, and it should be supporting the sale of or preventing the sale to minors, preventing the sale to intoxicated people, making sure that there's a way for an intoxicated customer to get home safely. The incident log, they should know how to handle emergency situations. And then the policy should also prohibit any promotions that encourage over drinking. And the servers should monitor customers' intake. Those are key things that the ABC would like to see in a written policy.
I would think that at this particular point in time, you can see how broad the coverage is of this particular program and how much education is going to be needed to implement it and to comply with it. Barbara, can you take us through the training and certification process details on this particular slide?
Sure. Current employees may not continue to be employed after July 1st, 2022, unless he or she takes the mandatory training program and passes the exam, and this should be done before July 1st, 2022. If they do not do that, they cannot be employed.
Now, we expect that there's going to be a lot of people falling into that category. And I think that the ABC is going to start issuing warnings, is going to be the first level. If precedent holds on implementation of these kind of requirements. However, by the time September of 2022 rolls around, I think you're going to start to see warnings being replaced with accusations. But Barbara, what about new employees?
New employees hired after July 1st, 2022 will have 60 days from the date they are hired to be certified. And there was a question, how long did the certification last? You must renew the certification every 3 years. So the certification lasts for 3 years.
Does that mean another total course or just another test?
No, it's another to renew. It's going through the same process, the take the course and take the test. It's estimated that the training course will take about 4 hours. And that's going to be amazing that you learn all of this in 4 hours. you can take it online or in person, but it has to be from an ABC approved provider. Plus, people have taken the LEAD courses, which was a simpler—
Licensee Education in Alcohol and Drugs.
Right, which was a simpler program. None of that will count. Anybody who has taken that course and was certified before April 1st, 2021, which is this current year, none of those courses will count, and you'll have to be RBS certified.
Now, who administers the exam?
The ABC has insisted that it will administer the exam. Apparently they don't trust the training providers for having a very severely monitored exam program. So it's the ABC, and in order to get on the to qualify for the exam, the next slide will show you what has to be disclosed to the ABC.
Well, we've got 70%.
Do you think the ABC going to charge each individual to take this exam? Are they going to?
It's going to be a minimal charge. We estimate the charge for a program is between $15 and $30 per person. And the exam, they're saying it's either $3 to $5 per person.
And that is minimal as compared to the hours of time that those employees are going to have to be not doing the job that they were hired to do.
Precisely. That's correct.
Now, in terms of who gets the program, how many languages is training going to be offered in, Barbara?
There are five basic languages that it must be. It's English, Spanish, Vietnamese, Mandarin, and Tagalog.
We have a lot of wineries in Sonoma that speak Tagalog, and they should be especially concerned with taking that particular program. I can't wait to see that program material myself. And like we said before, you've got three tries to pass it, and if you fail at three attempts, what happens?
You have to start all over. You cannot be employed if it's after July 1st, 2022.
From a calendaring standpoint, employees have to start taking it almost 60 days ahead of that July deadline in case they don't pass and don't memorize the vehicle code or whatever. So they have another chance to take the whole thing all over again. That puts it like into the first quarter of 2022.
Exactly.
That's exactly right. That's why we recommend starting now, frankly. As soon as we have a training program certified trainers, start now. I mean, this is a year, as this pandemic year has demonstrated, a year goes by pretty quickly, depending on if you're having fun or not.
Yeah.
We had another question come through about the course itself can be taken online or in person, but will the exam be taken? Does it need to be in person, or is there an option of an online?
That can also be online.
Great.
In terms of the other requirements, the certifications will be electronic. They'll no longer be a paper certification. And the ABC will keep an electronic record of every certified server. Now, on-premise licensees may only establish the validity of its employees' RBS server certification within the ABC's online certification system. Barbara, does this mean everybody has to be registered with the ABC?
Absolutely.
How about an employee maintaining its own records? Tell us how this record requirement works.
That will not be sufficient. Every record that's going to be verified must be at the ABC.
Now, what about recertification?
Recertification is by 3 years after the certification expires. You need to be recertified before it expires. And it's the same process. You need to take the course and pass the exam.
So looking forward, we've got a 2022 requirement, and then it's going to be a total zoo in 2025 when this rolls around again. I mean, that's kind of what I'm looking forward to. And unless, of course, there's legislative relief from this particular program in the interim of some sort. If you have complaints, talk to your state senator and your state assembly person and talk to them soon. We have a note on our slides here. The licensee may request the ABC to send automatic notifications of the online certification system prior to the employee's certificate expiration date, but then may decide to opt out of the automatic notification system. What's that mean, Barbara? Could you explain that?
Yes. Request the ABC automatic notifications, you have to sign up with the ABC for that service. That's the only thing they will provide, other than allowing you to check and verify certifications. Some people may not want to do that and should keep their own record of when their employees' certifications will expire. It's going to be incumbent upon the employer to make sure that their employees are recertified in a timely manner.
And this is going to go from this point going forward, unless the legislation on the program changes in the meantime. Now, let's talk for a moment about servers and managers. This is going to be an especially sensitive area because of the labor implications of appointing somebody a manager, the ABC implications of having a manager qualified by the ABC as if they're an owner. It's really pretty much the same ABC personnel affidavit qualification process. And the information that they're going to need. Barbara, can you review with us the information that has to be provided in connection with
in our comments, we raised privacy issues in security of the data, which we're hoping the ABC will keep confidential. Legal name, your birth date, your email address, your zip code of the current residence, and then the key is the personal identification, which is either the last four digits of your social security, a state issued identification number, a state issued driver's license, a tax identification number, employment identification number. And you need, when you're signing up, you need to inform the ABC which number you're using, which, and the important thing is that this is under penalty of perjury. So you
what that means, because we've done a lot of these cases, that if the form is filled out incorrectly and it's certified, the ABC will take action against the license premised on a false filing of a form. That's a very common ABC accusation. It's a difficult one too, because a lot of times people don't really understand what they're signing, and so a false certification action. In fact, depending on who does it, may involve the revocation of the particular license that's involved. Now, we don't expect to see a lot of winery revocations under this particular program or other types of licensees, unless it's an aggravated case, or the ABC doesn't like you, or your local police department doesn't like you, or your neighbors don't like you, because those are the people that get the heat, are the ones that have engendered complaints to local folks. And we'll talk about the penalties right now real quick. The guidelines is a 10-day suspension. Now, in most circumstances, a 10-day suspension can be avoided with a POIC, a petition and an offer of compromise. We pay a fine in lieu. We don't know if that's going to apply here or not yet. That's a point to be clarified. Second, what is suspended for 10 days? If it's a winery, are you simply suspending the tasting room privileges, which has happened? Or are you suspending the entire winery license? I mean, we would be sure or feel pretty confident that it would be only the tasting room privileges. But if this is a restaurant or bar or hotel, you know, then their privileges to serve alcohol would be suspended for 10 days. If you choose to try the case in front of an administrative law judge, who, by the way, is an ABC employee, and typically is an ex-ABC prosecutor, which is why we're so proud when we actually win a case in front of these guys. What they consider in terms of mitigation and aggravation in the new rules is the percentage of employees without a certification. So they will take on one particular licensee and they'll look at the whole picture. Because typically if you've only got, if they come in and look at, they're gonna find multiple employees without certification. The length of time the employees were employed without a certification, and prior warnings given to the ABC licensee regarding alcohol service certification requirements under the Act. This is why we think that the first level of enforcement is going to be warnings, probably through September of 2022. And, you know, and then they're going to start to get to put the hammer down on people that haven't listened to the warnings. The way to stay out of that particular requirement and not to have to call me or Jeremy or Kim or Barbara is to pay attention and do it now.
John, Barbara, we have a question that's interesting. What about temporary employees?
And coupled with that, John, thinking about this 60-day time limit for a new hire to be certified, or if that first person they start in June of 2022, but they fail the first one, when can they continue to serve? Can that temporary continue to serve? Can the person who failed the first time continue to serve? What are we going to run into an entirely temporary workforce here in the alcohol beverage industry?
It's beginning to look like that, Jeremy, because in fact, if you fail the exam, you can't continue to work. You can't continue to serve alcohol. if you've got a temporary employee coming in, you've got after July 1st, 2022, you've got 60 days to certify that temporary employee, which means that there may be a huge marketplace for temporary employees that are already certified.
Right.
We don't know. This is one of the unknown questions is what's going to happen. And typically you're going to get that kind of employee, for example, for large venue events, Bottle Rock. This is going to fall also heavily on the catering companies. But I know our time is running short here, so I want to give time for you of your stuff. But Barbara, you had a word about the clerk's affidavit. That's our last slide here.
Yeah, the clerk's affidavit has been in existence for a while, and it's requires every person who's off-premises sales, every person who sells alcoholic beverages in a retail store, they must read, understand, and sign the clerk's affidavit. It's a simpler understanding of the law. It's not as detailed, but if the clerk had any prior violations, they must declare that. And finally, the licensee must sign acknowledging the clerk signed affidavit. We asked in ABC about online sales, online retailers, and it's a gray area. The licensee affirmation of knowledge of the rules when they sign it as part of the license application will suffice right now. And the workers for the online retailer do not need to sign the clerk's affidavit, but that could change.
Yeah, well, this is one of the issues, items that should be on your business, doing business checklist. And the association will have this particular checklist. And Kim, our slides, I think, will be available to your association members. Is that not correct?
That's my understanding, correct.
Madison, I should talk to Madison about this one. But, you know, these slides will be available at the end of this program. So unless there's any other questions, that's our program for the Responsible Beverage Service part of this particular program.
There was one question. What's the state's justification for this massive new program?
And or does there have to be one?
Well, that's pretty much the answer, Kim. There doesn't have to be one. It's the legislation in 2017 that the ABC really pushed. And there's also part of the justification comes from Alcohol Justice, which is an anti-alcohol group out of Marin County that has decried the use of alcohol throughout the state, and is considered that all alcohol use is evil. And therefore, if you're going to permit it, it has to be permitted under very carefully controlled and legal conditions. And frankly, there wasn't enough attention paid by the industry when this law was passed in 2017. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, we all have ourselves to blame for this, of not paying enough attention to these laws as they pass. 2022 is going to be on us before we all know it. And so anyway, if there's any other questions.
A final question was, do these laws apply when a California winery is pouring out of state? The answer is no.
No, it applies in California. But hopefully this law doesn't go to other states.
Oh.
You know, that would become a nightmare.
Kim, you're on.
So I have a piece of this program that talks about the winery updates. And I'll put my screens on for a minute. But interestingly enough, there's a lot of connection between the two. When John started talking about this, he said, it depends on what activities you do at your winery. Just so you know, there's activities and there's events. So that distinction matters. And that's what I'm going to be talking about for a minute. Another thing that's a good tie-in is they talked about the term certified manager, both Barbara and John, that there's all these requirements for a certified manager, but nobody really knows what that is. Well, we have the same thing with the use permits. So I'm gonna talk for a minute, I'll put my slides up in a minute, talk for a little bit about the winery ordinance that Sonoma County's working on and why it matters to you who already have a use permit. And the gist of that is the definitions. Your use permit, I bet you a dollar, contains definitions that are undefined in the code. and with this new winery use permit ordinance that they say only applies to new wineries, I'll bet you $10 it gets applied to yours. So you really do need to, I'm going to focus on the part of the ordinance that really does just affect us that already have a winery use permit. So if you can see the winery ordinance updates, AKA, yes, we still do not have definitions for the terms in your current use permit. You're being enforced under those imaginary definitions. And when a new person comes into PRMD, they have their own idea of what those definitions mean. And this is part of the problem and why we need to worry so much about this new winery ordinance. There's a brief history here. I've been on the winery, the Vintners Governmental Relations Board since I think 2013, possibly 2012. It's all swims in the past. And we've all been trying to work on these things for a while. The big picture is the Board of Supervisors took control of the project and said, this is what we want PRMD staff to do. The PRMD staff worked and spent a bunch of money and then came back to the Planning Commission this June. Many of us I know attended that hearing. It was interesting. And the hearing was on June 3rd. And the big picture at the end of that was that the Planning Commission said, staff, you need to go back and look at definitions again, because they were essentially presenting us another bunch of rules where things weren't properly defined. These are the things I'm going to talk about today. In interest of time, I'm not going to summarize them. I'll just sort of go right into them. The new winery ordinance, when it is finished and passed, it only applies to new use permits. So you think, okay, it doesn't matter to me, but it also applies to use permit modifications. So even if you go into PRMD and ask, and this is the sort of thing I do all the time, you ask for a change in production amount, or you want a new building, or you want to move your tasting room from this place to that place, yes, that does require a use permit. And arguably, any small change in a use permit like that would open up this entire Pandora's box of having to comply with the new winery use permit ordinance. There's a potential carve out. Vintners is working really hard and trying to get a carve out. And then the third prong on my arrow, the county was very clear in its June 3rd hearing that it could not possibly affect current holders. But I 100% disagree, because they are defining ag promotional events. And right now there is no definition of ag promotional events. And that's generally what we have in our use permit. So I really do need your guys' help in I'll tell you more about this later. One of the big pushes that Vintners has been doing and other local agencies is trying to say that some things a winery does are just things a winery does. It's not an event. And we're calling those activities. And some things are an event. You have 500 people for a circus wine party wedding. Okay, well, that's obviously an event. We say kind of in the parlance, if you have to have porta potties and parking people, it's probably an event. If you don't, you can do it on your own property. It's an activity. But historically, whoever's come into PRMD, whoever your enforcement officer is, whoever your planner is, they get to decide whether something's an event or an activity, whether something's normal or not. So one good thing coming out of this ordinance is there's sort of a recognition that there are two different things, and then we just have to fight over what they are. They are defining activities, and your activities would be unlimited in numbers, and that lets you be flexible to the market. Events, you have to get those in your use permit, as we know. How to define an activity and event. For anybody who attended that hearing, you heard lots of different creative ideas from the planning commissioners who perhaps read the material more thoroughly than others. Some of them did. What we are encouraging is what Dry Creek is using, which is called the MPOT, maximum persons at one time. And when you apply for a new use permit or a use permit modification, you would get that number. How many people you could have visitors on your property at one time. And you know what? What you do doesn't matter, because the whole CEQA impact issue is impact. And so if they're there for a wine pickup party, if they're there for a winemaker lunch, if they're there for a very large tasting, it doesn't matter what they're there for, as long as they're within your maximum person at one time. I like it because it's best for enforcement. You could essentially, if a code enforcement comes, you throw a net over everybody and you just count them. Whereas if you have 200 people or 100 person or 50 people during the day, it's very difficult to enforce that. And you have one neighbor saying, I'm sure there were 200 people there. And you have the winery saying, nope, there were only 50 because I had 50 tickets. The MPOT would be set at the time of the use permit, and it's based on your infrastructure. And so a big parcel with a larger property with a more intensive use would have a different MPOT than a smaller winery do. So it's also very flexible, which is good. The planning commissioners and staff have had other clever ideas. One of them is the time of the day, that whether or not it's a regular winery business activity depends on the time of the day. Some of them want to just really get into your business and figure out, well, what are you doing? You can do this and you can't do that. Of course, they wouldn't say that to a restaurant or a church or a plumber, but apparently they can say that to a winery. Some of the planning commissioners say, if you charge a fee, it's an event. So all of you who charge a fee for wine tasting, that could be a little problematic. Another one felt very strongly that if they made an appointment or reservation, it became an event. Again, for those of you who have tastings by appointment or reservation, that would be a problem. And some wanted to define it by type of food service, which I don't know, it's just odd. Don't even know what to say about that.
Tim, I think some of them would define it by who the acoustic guitarist is that shows up on a Saturday afternoon. If I have John Hinman coming to play acoustic guitar at my tasting room.
Oh, that's clearly event entertainment.
But if I hired a top name talent, well, that's something else.
Jeremy is not joking. That's actually what was discussed at the Planning Commission hearing.
How are they going to enforce this? I mean, are there code enforcement officers going around?
They have beefed up the code enforcement department. It's under the building division, which I think is interesting, as opposed to planning. They've hired retired sheriff's officers, and they're not used to compromising. Let me just say it that way. So the code enforcement officer would get the report. They sometimes contact the winery ahead of time. Sometimes they do not. Sometimes they just do their investigation and issue a notice of violation to the winery. And then you have a very short period of time to deal with it, or it's a done deal. So thanks for that, John. That was a good question.
Well, I'm wondering also whether they interface with the other regulators.
They do. They sometimes do. They sometimes do not. Right now, there's a little political infighting between two different departments of the county, so that if one county finds something out, they don't tell the other part of the county, but I don't know if that's the same with ABC. And this is one of the things, they never asked, one of my biggest concerns about this winery event ordinance is that they never even asked code enforcement for their opinion and what would be enforceable and what wouldn't be enforceable. I'm trying to keep on schedule here, so I got a book here. The current draft of the winery ordinance has different times for different things. They think they're being flexible, but if you just looked at the underlined portions, a pickup party between 10 a.m. and 5 p.m. is an activity. You can have as many of those as you want. But if you look down under events on the underlined items, a release party is an event that must be called out in your permit, and a club party has to be called out in your use permit. But a pickup party does not, which just shows they don't really understand the business at all. There's a lot of things here on these parcel size limitations, which I'm happy to talk to anybody about. Just give me a call. Same thing on traffic and parking. We need to stay flexible. That's kind of what I'm talking about here. You know, the wine business has changed a lot in a short period of time. Unfortunately, the county right now says the current view of your use permit is that if it's not expressly listed there, you can't do it. So all of you who participate in industry-wide events, you're just doing it by the grace of PRMD. According to their understandings. Part of the problem is everybody's new. There, as many of you know, there was a big retirement change in the county government, and almost every PRMD staff member of any seniority just retired. Everybody got moved up or they hired new people. So those people are very new. We have several new planning commissioners, at least five new planning commissioners, and they're relying on the new staff. And then we have at least one new supervisor, right? Chris Corsi. So there's a lot of, and those of us who've been doing this for a long time find it very frustrating to have the same conversation over again. So this is my to-do list for you. That yes, it does matter to you, and it will likely be applied retroactively, even though they say it won't, just because of the definitions. And when you go to events where there's supervisors or go to events where there's planning commissioners, I need you to figure out where they're sitting and go over and talk to them and let them know about your business, because it was astonishing, and we'll get into this in a minute, astonishing how little they knew about how the business worked. your own supervisor, you really should have a good relationship with him or her, because they can really help you out with a lot of things. They're not just somebody that you vote for or don't vote for. They really have a lot of good advice to give, and they can really help you manage things. Don't forget the other supervisors, because they do have a vote. So if anything of yours comes up before the Board of Supervisors, it's nice if they know you ahead of time. My suggestion, and this is from Vintners as well as many other groups, Dry Creek as well, that MPOT, the maximum persons at one time, is probably the best model. It's not perfect. And it's because it's flexible to the size of the parcel. It seems to be flexible enough for the market, and it's easier to enforce. So that's good for everybody. Here's just some hearing notes, and these are worth staying a few extra minutes because they admit they didn't consult with code enforcement. One of the commissioners spent a lot of quality time talking about how we should define a party. Of course, party wasn't part of the winery event ordinance language. Wineries don't typically hold parties just for fun. They're usually to make money or to sell their product or upscale their label. So it was just discouraging to hear a planning commissioner talk about the term party so much. There was another commissioner that spent a lot of time talking about how Sonoma Valley has done a lot of work and we should just use their definitions. Dry Creek has done the most work, yay for you guys. And Dry Creek's parameters are sanctioned by the county as well. One commissioner said that she didn't want to have any events at all or any activities because these would be people using the public roads for their private commercial gain. And you didn't really know what to say about that because, of course, if you have, as Jeremy points out to me all the time, if you have a sale at a car dealership, well, apparently you're using public roads for a private purpose. No, no, no. But that is one of the planning commissioners, and she was quite adamant. And then I was actually insulted. And this is my last piece. I was insulted actually by PRMD staff saying that if anybody's use permit is unclear, all they have to do is come in and apply for a use permit modification and get some clarity. And I wish I could see all of you because you should all be laughing at that or just be plain darn sad, because applying for a use permit modification is generally an expensive project that takes a lot of time, that requires a lot of specialty studies and almost always an attorney, if not to work in the background to help push things down the line. And of course, that is what I do every day, right? I'm happy to do it. But it's not fair to just say, if your use permit is unclear, all you have to do is apply for a use permit modification.
That point, I think, really just needs extra emphasis because what happens to your use permit once you go in and apply for your modification?
Well, you still have your old use permit until the very minute that you get your modification. And what happens 25 to 30% of the time is much of the way through the process, thanks, Jeremy, the people just give up and say, I've spent my $100,000. I'm keeping the use permit I already have. And that's not a good use of money. This pandemic world of trying to keep wineries afloat and do new things and be creative and have your brand stand out, you want clarity. And so
I have one question.
Yeah, John.
Is it possible to, because I mean, you're talking about Sonoma County here, but you've got a different set of definitions in Sonoma Valley. You got a different set of definitions in Napa. You got a different set of depositions or definitions.
Santa Barbara.
Paso Robles, yeah. I was going to say. Is it possible to initiate statewide definitions through the legislature?
Well, anything is possible. And many years back, we did we did quite a detailed analysis of all of the regulations and rules in the different counties. And we compared them all and we thought, why don't we just pick one that somebody else has done before? And it didn't work. Some counties were kind of big flat squares. And our county isn't a big flat square. Some counties really wanted parcel size limits. This is my opinion and my opinion only. I am against parcel size limitations because it will increase the residential nature of ag land. If you have to have 20 acres or 50 acres or even 10 acres in order to have a winery under this new use permit scheme, then a parcel that's 9.5 acres can only be sold for residents. And then you've got more residents living on ag land and squeezing out the agricultural nature of that land. So whether we should have statewide definitions, I can't, it's just such a far-fetched thing to even get it through the county, John, that I have, it would take another 20 years to get it done, but I'm not saying it wouldn't be a bad idea. Maybe we could work on that.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the things to have uniformity in ag lands across the state, because the problems you're describing are dealt with in every single county of the state.
They are. So if you take anything away from my message, I want you to know that everybody is working hard and trying to get some definitions, that the definitions will apply to you. Please provide the planning commissioners with your input and your information about how you run your business, as well as your commissioners, as well as your supervisors. And it's really important. And when Mike or when anybody at Vintner sends you those emails about showing up for something, please do. In 2016, I think there were 500 people. I did a blog, John, for you, for your firm on this. 500 people showed up, half with torches and pitchforks about wineries, and the other half with t-shirts. And it was a very spirited meeting. People have lost interest. Very few people spoke at the last meeting, and the planning commissioners kind of took over the show. So thanks everybody for listening. If you have any questions or if you'd like to apply for a use permit modification, please give us a call. There we are. And I think we're finishing.
I'd like to just put in a last word, because you just mentioned it, Kim. If you have questions about stuff we have blogged on a lot of these issues at Booze Rules, which you can just Google Booze Rules, it's beveragelaw.com. And there's a lot of good information. Barbara's done a lot of it there on these particular topics, and they're open for everybody. So, take advantage of the educational material that's out there, both on the Carl Mackey website and on ours.
Great. Well, I so appreciate you all participating. This has been super informative. We had a really great turnout today, and I'll be looking forward to sharing these materials and the recordings with the remainder of our members. And so again, just want to thank you, John, Barbara, Kim, and Jeremy for participating today. And
could we just answer one question, which is a good one because of COVID? It says, if you're unemployed, is the RBS course accessible? The answer is yes. And if it is and get hired, will you have to take it again? And the answer is no.
Great.
You will be certified.
Perfect. Well, thank you for that, Barbara. And yes, if you guys have any questions, definitely reach out to these folks. They're very educated and know all the ins and outs to all these regulations. So thank you so much again, and we look forward to seeing you next time.
Thank you, Madison.
Thank you.